here to talk about when data attacks. Me and Max are the creative team, well, part of the creative team here at Jellyfish, and you might not always think data and creativity go well together. You've seen a few examples here today. I'm Richard West, I'm head of creative, as you already know, and me and Max have been working together for about 7 years now, would you say, Max?
Yeah, 6-7 years.
I think so. My background is very much art direction. So I'm the pictures, Max, and you are the...
The words. So my background has been copy and content. I came here originally 6.5 years ago as head of copy and started working with Richard straight away as two different sides of the creative coin. And it's great having the art, the artistic and the sort of rational, emotional side of what we do come together. So we do have these two opposing sides, and it's the way ad teams worked years ago, to have a writer and an art director, but we've got this in a more modern digital world. But it still seems to work rather well, doesn't it?
All about partnerships, Max.
All about partnerships, Richard.
Just saying, 1,000 words. And pictures, I don't know whether
you've heard, and yet you need the words to say that, Richard. You need the words. But just to say, Steve Jobs said the most amazing thing. If you've read his biography, you know what an egocentrical, self-centered, awful man he was, but an absolute genius at the same time. And he said this: great things in business are never done by one person, they're done by a team of people. And if he said that, then it's something that anyone can adhere to and believe in. And we do. I think it's absolutely true. It does take it. And it is a combination of the words and pictures from a creative point. It is the emotional and the rational that work together. It is the sense of the human and the technology. I am, by the way, the least mathematical person in this room. I'm the least data-driven, the least analytical. It will go completely wrong. It will set an alarm off. And it is the art and science coming together.
Exactly, and we're here to talk about that relationship. It's a blend. It's not just art and words and pictures, rather. I can't even get that right. It's a lot of different things in the agencies, this ecosystem that we need to make sure is right for the best creative outcomes. And obviously there's the opposing view around data and creativity. I just wanted you to read this quote here from a very talented creative director at Google. You can look at historical information to inform a point of view, but at the end of the day, you have to have an opinion, and data is not an opinion. So you need that level, that layer of intuition. And we're going to take you through a number of different case studies, some of the work we've done here at Jellyfish and some of the great work that we've seen recently as well, that both paint the picture of data and creativity and that blend and how they come together. Because we know that with personalization, with data-driven creative inspired by data, whatever you want to call it, it pays off. And in fact, it's no longer desired, it's expected. And so that's something to be thinking about. In fact, we've got so much data, we don't know really what to do with it. We're in a digital agency here at Jellyfish. We've got powerful data, we've got powerful creativity, yes, and so many different data points. You know, just listing a few up here, the audience signals, the demographics, the CRM, the website, affinity audience data, social APIs, and sometimes it gets a bit crazy and we need a tight brief. We need to understand what actually we should be executing on. And occasionally we put our hands up and say, just because you can, doesn't mean you should, and we need to be that emotionally led side of the thing.
Totally. Yeah, thank you. But being this more emotive side of the way we work here creatively, we started looking around at some case examples that mean something a little bit different. So what do you do when the data says one thing and you ignore it? What if you've got all the data information coming in, telling you one thing, and your intuition says, do you know what, we're not going to go along with that? What happens then? So it is this sense of creative intuition that always fascinates me. And we're going to talk about a case study example here, where last year there was a massive political statement during a sporting event. And it was such a dramatic one. It had never happened before. It created such a furore that everybody was up in arms about it. There was anger, there was fury. I think even because it's the 4th of July, I thought we'd...
Let's not leave that up
you
there too
have
long,
him.
Max.
Who is American? You can have him. I'm just going to say
can,
no.
Quick.
But even the fury of the President of America saying this guy should be sacked. Of course, it was Colin Kaepernick taking the knee during the NFL game when the American national anthem was on. I've spent some time in America, as a lot of people I'm sure have, and that's not what you do. You do not do this, but he made a point. He stood up and made a point. That anger that was screaming about him. If you were a brand, would you then go, do you know what? That's the guy we want to be associated with. Of course it isn't, but Nike did. And Nike made this amazing campaign, believe in something, even if it means sacrificing everything. And they went ahead with it. They stuck with their gut feeling and their creative intuition and went along with this. And when I did the research into this, there's a bit of you going, yeah, but I bet it went wrong. I bet their sales died. I bet everything fell apart. Because as soon as they did this, it was just burn it campaign. Everything went wrong. but amazingly, it didn't. There was an initial dip and then a 14% increase in sales, a 5% increase in stock value, which equated to $6 billion, and a well-deserved Grand Prix win at Cannes. And I think that is just an amazing example of data telling you one thing and your creative intuition telling you a completely different one, and that's how it can work.
Wow, how do you follow that? Well, we did do a little bit of work with NFL, not quite as powerful as that in that respect. But when the creative learns from the data, so sometimes you don't always have the right data points, you don't know enough about your customer. So how do you learn on the job, as it were? This is a project we did for NFL Game Pass, where we're trying to get people to buy our video on demand service for NFL. So we needed a creative that would inspire people who like sport. And obviously, we needed to know a little bit more about their team. This is about data learning from the individual. This was a prospecting banner that we created, follow your team. We didn't know what team you followed. So what would we do? We have this interactive product, if you like, to try and find out what they liked. And actually, if they interacted and clicked through, in this example, to, trying to remember the name of the team, there's 32 of them, I think it's the Green Bay Packers, we'd see a little bit more information about that team, what they're up to, what recent win they might have had. And then the next time we saw that user, that human, if you like, we saw this creative being being put in front of them. So this is the Green Bay Packers ad that you'd get. It was relevant because actually it was video content from last week's match. It was something that you would be intrigued about because it's your actual team that you're following. And this relevant, this relatable, this personalized creative, we saw fantastic results from. I mean, it was not cheap to build. I mean, you think about 14,000 different iterations of all the different types, of all the different possibilities here throughout the season. But what we saw is that investment paid off, and it eventually paid for itself, which was fantastic.
And another picking on data again. So what happens when data confirms the bad news? What happens when the data gives you information that you think, do you know what, I really didn't want to hear that. I didn't want to think that this was happening to me, but it did. And here's a very interesting case study that we had where creative intuition created this brilliant idea for the New York Public Library. So all their stats were saying no one's coming in. Like probably every library in the country, in the world, people aren't going into libraries anymore. So what did they do? They could have done a campaign, they could have run special offers, they could have done out of home, they could have done press to get people back into the library. But they had the most wonderful idea of, well, if everybody's on their phone, do the simplest creative idea you can imagine and just go with the flow. Don't fight it. Put your books where they are. So onto Instagram, they created these select novels, animated. Each illustrator is a different illustrator for the book, created by Mother in New York. And it's the most beautiful way of getting the product into the customer's hands. The data says they're not coming in. You go, well, okay, they're not coming in. What are we going to do? We're going to go with the flow and work it this way. It's absolutely
love
beautiful.
That because not only is it beautiful, it's art direction led, it's illustration, it's interactive, but also it sort of subverts the format of what you might expect of Instagram stories being very ephemeral, being almost quickly flicked through and that's all you see. This is something you might want to pore over and actually spend several hours looking at. It's
reading
beautiful.
The words.
Yes. Yeah. We're looking at the pictures too. I just, it's both really, Max, is what we're saying. There's a blend here.
Yeah.
A few more pictures to talk through now, if that's
words.
Okay.
Read the words
yeah,
first,
there is words on that one. When data finds the right audience. So this was a campaign we worked with recently for Clarins. Clarins were doing a lot of retargeting. They were doing a lot of critio. I'm not going to say that word ever again. That's what they were doing. And, it wasn't really respecting the audience. It wasn't really thinking about actually people buying beauty products, thinking about the age group. In your 20s, is very different skin type to when you're 60. So actually what we needed to do is find out the demographic, find out the data, find out the audience types. And this was the banner that we created. It was a dynamic banner that did a lot of different things. In fact, throughout the funnel, we were creating and crafting this experience to actually make people aware of the product, what the ingredients were on the product, what your age and demographic were. We were giving you a specific quote. So here's an example for someone in their 20s. And this gives you a sense of how we built that. This is an isometric view of all the different layers that you got here. Whether it be the lovely branded elements, whether it was more of an ingredient list, or actually whether we were trying to tip people over the edge with the purchase by giving them a sense of a free gift. It was a beautiful piece of work, and it was definitely not the C word. It was something that was crafted, had a branded experience, used the right fonts, the colours, all the lovely video content that we had here. And this gives you an example of those three different demographics that are actually serving those individuals with. So the great news is we beat Critio. There we go. I used the word again. Apologies.
But I hear you ask, what happens if you can't connect the data to your customers? This is a final point that I want to make about data and emotional creative. And it's a really interesting case study of social listening, throwing up lots and lots of figures about some interesting facts, about an interesting demographic at a very interesting time of the year, but it's got nothing to do with your company, absolutely nothing to do with your brand at all. So how do you bring the two together? Well, the way of creative voice, and I think a creative tone of voice is one of the most important things you can get to identify a brand, and it's not something that they could throw at you, it's something you have to work on and create yourself. And this is what Burger King did. So no one is happy all the time. They partnered with Mental Health America to come up with this brilliant idea that did two things really neatly, and you may have picked up on them both. One, Happy Meals. That's what McDonald's do. They do Happy Meals. Well, no one is happy all the time. There's a video that went along with this called Let Me Feel My Way. And please watch it. The production values of it are just absolutely amazing. The soundtrack is beautiful. It's really moving. But they created these lunchboxes for 1 week going, don't give a F meal. Don't feel myself. I want to be on my own today meal. The absolute opposite of a Happy Meal. It's not what a fast food brand is. Fast food brand is fun, color, light, happiness. And they went, well, we're not like that. We're not like that all the time. It's a wonderful campaign to get the voice across in a totally different way, in one that really moves you. I think it's just a beautiful, sympathetic thing to do. And over the years, Burger King have moved further and further away from just being jazz hands with a Happy Meal. Never thought I'd say that. But what it is unexpected, disruptive, it's many things, but thoughtful, empathetic, relevant, truthful, distinctive, respectful, that campaign. If I asked you what you thought of Burger King before I showed you that ad, I bet you not one of you would use any of those words. It would be, oh, it's just food and it's horrible and it's, I eat it when I'm drunk and I eat it when I'm sober, I eat it all the goddamn time, I don't know myself. It's none of those things. But you see an ad like that and it shifts your perception of the brand. That tone of voice is so powerful, it comes up with phrases like that, which I think absolutely blow my mind. But if we just bring it back to the UK, because we've done some things here that are pretty cool, Greggs launched a vegan sausage roll. Their Twitter feed. Nobody was waiting for a vegan bloody sausage, you PC ravaged clowns. Piers Morgan. Oh, Piers, we've been expecting it. This is a tone of voice from a brand like Greggs that is so good. Did it work? This year they've topped 1 billion sales, 50% growth in pre-tax profits. Shares have surged to record high, partly because of the product, partly because of what they do. And of course, Piers Morgan is still Piers Morgan.
They just love showing angry men.
Didn't
I
change
think, here, somehow. Max.
It's something
Let's
like
move
that.
On from
it's
there.
It's something
I think.
Like that.
But something that's quite British, the vegan sausage roll, to something even more British, the weather. And I think we touched on this earlier with Nelly and Sophie. But this was about user data driving creative performance. And just to give you a little bit of a story behind this, we didn't actually have a lot of data when we got the brief from Toyota around this, you know, business as usual campaign here to try and make sure people came to our website to look at the things we could sell around after sales. But what we did think, and this is the sort of emotional piece, if you like, it's lovely, beautiful weather out today, but generally up and down the country, it can be anything. And what we found that unified both all the way from 18 to 80-year-olds, what's the one thing that brings people together? The weather, I think.
Weather.
That's what it was, and that's what Toyota loves. So there's an emotionally led thing here, but it was actually backed up by the data and that lovely weather API. And I actually found out for the first time that rain won. I think that's fantastic. So maybe in our next campaign, we just need to activate when it's raining, which is all the time anyways, somewhere in Britain, so we'll be absolutely fine. And I think, you know, the expression here, that lovely video content that we were using is just beautifully led. That's fantastic.
But what about the future? We went to, Rich and I went to a very interesting talk a few days ago, and I can't use the swear word that he used, but the question was at the end of it, what is the future of creative and copy and art design and visual and tone of voice? And he said, no one effing knows. He said, no, well, anyone can sort of vaguely predict what's going to happen, but we don't really know what's going to happen at all. But has anyone seen this? Sunspring, a science fiction film made by an AI bot. It wrote the script. This is AI writing this script.
In a future with mass unemployment, young people are forced to sell blood. It's something I can do.
You should see the boy and shut up. I was the one who was going to be 100 years old.
Well, I saw him again. The way you were sent to me, that was a big, honest idea. I am not a bright light.
Well, I have to go to the skull. I don't know.
Ooh. Huh. What do you mean?
Well, I don't know anything about any of this, so.
Then what?
There's no answer.
We're going to see the money.
It's baffling.
Honestly, it is the most engaging and mad film, but it was this AI machine was fed science fiction scripts, one after the other, and told to write a
script. You're not out of a job, is what we're saying at that point.
Sadly. But the absolute madness of this thing, it didn't make any sense, but there were the occasional lines in it that were absolutely beautiful. It was very well acted. The actors adored doing this thing. They really enjoyed the thing. They made a sequel to this, which was actually written by humans, but it had a choreographed dance routine in it, choreographed by AI, and it's actually really good. And it's madness. This is about 3 years old, and it's sort of laughable in its poor quality of script, and yet there's still something quite magical about it. The sentences do work. They do sort of make sense if you take enough drugs. But anyway, moving forward. So whatever happens in the future, data has to inform us and creative has to move us. That's the only thing it can ever be. If the creative isn't moving, those campaigns we've seen today, they move you. If it doesn't move you, then it's not working at all in my eyes. And just as an interesting little thing, I don't know if you know IBM Watson, but it's an interesting way that you can put your copy through this test to have it analyzed. So when we drop in the phrase data has to inform us, creative has to move us, it's confident, that top one, and it's analytical. And this is an interesting piece of machine learning. So you get spell checks and you get Gmail, which should complete your sentences for you. But this is so brilliant, it will scan what you've written. Is it biased? Is it angry? Is it sounding a little bit too joyous? And it will filter out what you're writing to help you in certain cases. Now, it may get more and more like this. It may get to the point where writing is completely homogenized. And when it does, then it comes down to us to create something even more interesting, as technology always does.
There'll be one for pictures, I'm sure, as well. Very, very soon, Max, and you can rely on that. Thank you very much. If we could just click through to the next one. Great. And so just to sum up briefly, this is about relationships. This is about a relationship when it comes to creative, but wider with strategy, with planning, with all the things you need, data, all important. And it's getting that performance right. It's replacing the subjectivity with fact, that actually you have those partnerships that you can deliver great creative. And the only pie chart you will see in our presentation is this one. So we talked about data attacking. Well, you know, just leave that with you to read, but there is a big segment there, I don't know how, 47% you might say, that contributes to the sale of a product. I think we're in an okay place at the moment. And finally, one thing to leave you on, this very nice quote here by the CEO of Y&R, data isn't powerful on its own. As creatives, we have to be the best users of data, and I think that's what's important. There's so much out there, we have to understand it, it has to be distilled in a good brief. We have to really make sure that it's rigorously considered, and also the creative response that should come out of it. Otherwise, we could be in a world...
like this.
Exactly. This is a scary prospect. I don't know if anyone saw this a couple of years ago, but this is the dystopian future dreamt up by a 13-year-old schoolboy, I think, because it's a bit of a worry. But hopefully our creative response or our connection with technology won't be anything like this. It just goes on and on and on. I urge you to have a look at it, and we can share the link if you want. This is someone's journey on the bus, going to work, going around the supermarket, and seeing what potentially could be in your peripheral vision or front and centre.
It's not the Minority Report, cool world, you think it's going to be.
It's pretty, it's pretty bad, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's very spammy. That's what
it just goes
want.
On and on. You do get
we
quite
don't
drawn
want
into
that,
it,
Max.
But it's
we
like
don't
eating
want
a load of sweets.
And we'll leave that with you.
With your
Thanks
eyes.
Very much indeed. Appreciate
yes,
that.
Thank you.